start hitting the wrong notes, I quit trying to catch up.
That's me. I don't know what I'm playing on the record.
Sounds better to quit than it is to keep digging. You know?
Yeah.
Hey, on this other one, the second song, you don't mind me, or do you care if I play the intro with you?
No, I don't care at all.
Okay.
Let me play it through once, which I'll probably do while she's praying. That way you can get the tempo.
That'd be fine.
And then start with me.
So we'll basically go through it three times? Once and then.
I mean, it's going to be the same, because it's the same chords when I start singing.
Okay,
so
cool.
Keep,
I'm gonna follow you.
Thank you.
Glorious things are spoken of you. You make everything.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. You can have a seat for a minute. Good morning. Good morning. If you are worshiping online with us, as well as those who are here, we welcome you to Encounter. You know, if Jesus has made your life beautiful and glorious, how about you give me a hallelujah? Ah, lots of you. Good. That's good news. Thanks to the band, they're back today. We're so glad to have you guys back with us and glad everyone's well. We're in for a treat with all the music today. It's going to be a great day. Let me share with you a few things that are happening. First of all, our poinsettias, every year we offer you the opportunity to purchase poinsettias in memory or in honor of a loved one, and then we post their names on Christmas Eve. And so if you would like to do that, there's still time until tomorrow. Cost is $8 each, and we sent out an email with the link to it. So if you don't have that, let me know. But it's easy to just go online and do it that way. Or if you want to write a check today, you can do that. Just make sure you mark it poinsettias, but you'll need to let us know who it's for. So we'll take care of that. Four ways of giving. Of course, we appreciate your generosity so much. And just to remind you of the ways that you can continue to give and support the mission and ministries of this church. First of all, of course, the box there at the back that is marked, you can put your offerings in there. You can give online securely at our website, bullardfumc.org. You can mail your check to our P.O. Box 152. Or you can drop it at the church office drop box. The office will be closed this week, so if you do need anything, any pastoral care needs, contact David or I, and we will certainly respond to you. Also, as a reminder, your Bible app, which is on your phone, hopefully, we're in there. So all you have to do is open that up, and down at the bottom, there should be a tab that says More. If you click on that, then you'll see Events as one of the choices. You click on Events, and it should pull up Bullard FUMC. Once you open that up, you're going to see the sermon notes for today. You will see the Connect card, which you can complete online. You know, it's really easy. All you have to do really is put your name in there and then submit it, and that way we'll know you are here. Otherwise, you can also give us your prayer requests on the Connect card, and we will be praying for your needs. So we hope you'll utilize that. Christmas Eve is coming up. Wow, this is the 20th. I can't believe how fast this month has flown. Our Christmas Eve services will have two. One will be in here at 5 p.m. on Christmas Eve. The other will be at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary. And both will include candlelight, and both will include communion. So it's going to be a wonderful time, and we hope you will plan to join us. Excuse me, join us for one of those. The children had planned their musical, and of course we had to postpone it, but I think it's kind of, God worked it out the way it was supposed to be. It's going to be on the 27th, which is during the Christmas season. So we hope that you will join us. They're going to perform in both services on December the 27th, and it's called A Socially Distanced Christmas. Should be interesting. So I'll look forward to that and hope you'll join us. Youth Sunday School is going to resume. That's kids in grades 6 through 12. They are going to start back on January the 10th, meeting at 10 o'clock in the upper room behind the sanctuary. So please be aware of that. And our wild and wacky family fun hour will take place today. They'll be meeting right out there where the chairs are set up. So be sure your kids get involved with that. And then we have our alternative Christmas, which is a way for you to give to three different charities that we have selected. You can go online and do that easily. Select the charity and your gift amount, and then you'll get an email that you can give to the recipient, letting them know that you have honored them with this gift. Also, if you'd rather have a paper card, I have those that I can give to you as well. I think that's all that I have. So let's open with a word of prayer. Gracious Lord, your Spirit is with us here, Lord. And so we ask that you speak to our hearts. During this season, Lord, sometimes it's been tough to be filled with joy. But if we look to you, Jesus, you are our source of joy and peace and hope, and the one in whom we have all faith. Bless us here today, Lord, as we listen to the music, fill our hearts, and may the message speak to us and transform us by your word. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lowly exile here, until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from afar, who orders all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and teach us in your ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, again I say rejoice, for unto us is born the Savior of the world. Take heart, O weary soul, take heart, for help is on his way, and holy is his name. Rejoice, again I say rejoice, for unto us is born the Savior of the world. Take heart, a weary soul, take heart, for help is on its way, and holy is his name. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, again I say rejoice, for unto us is born the Savior of the world. Take heart, O weary soul, take heart, help is on its way, and hope. His name, holy is his name. Holy is his name. Oh, holy is his name. Oh, holy is his name.
Father, your name is so holy. God, we love you so completely, Father. Before I spoke a word,
before I spoke a word, you were singing over me.
You've been so good.
You have been so, so good to me.
Before I even took a breath,
before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me.
You've been so kind.
Yeah, you have been so, so kind to me.
Lifted up, oh, the overwhelming,
oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah.
When I was your foe,
when I was your foe, still your love fought for me. Yeah, you have been so, so good to me.
God, when I felt no worth,
when I felt no worth, you paid it all for me.
Been so kind.
Yeah, you have been so, so kind to me.
Holy, overwhelming,
holy, overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn, don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. This is the Christmas story. There's no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. There's no wall you won't break down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. There's no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. There's no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. And oh, there's no wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. There's no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. No, there's no wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending. Make you sing it. Oh, we chase. Leave the 99. I couldn't earn it. Yeah. Oh. Of God, oh, you chase it, fights till I'm found. You leave the 99. I couldn't earn it, God. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. God, we can't say thank you enough. God, thank you for you that you came, God. Thank you for your son. God, this time of year we're overwhelmed with the remembrance of your goodness and your grace. And we praise you with everything we have, Father. As we continue this morning, God, stay in this place. We ask you that with all of our hearts, stay in this place. Thank you so much. We love you so much. In your name I pray, Father. Amen. Please join the Walker family in our Advent moment.
From Luke 1, 26 through 38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. How will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin. The angel answered, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word to me be fulfilled. Then the angel left her.
We live on the brink every day. We stand on the threshold between this world and the next one. We live and move between the ordinary and divine, between the mundane and the mystery. Too often we forget to look up and see the angels in our living room. We forget that the love we give and live is a sign of eternity. God with us right now. We forget that company is coming.
Luke tells us that God's favor came to a girl, an ordinary girl. It might have been you or your daughter. It might have been the girl down the street or your grandchild. But the messenger of God came and greeted her and said, The Lord is with you. What a gift and a promise. Emmanuel, God is with us.
We light these candles with peace in our hearts for the promise of proximity, the nearness of God. Even when we forget to listen, to lean into that presence, God is as close as our own breath. This, in a confused and confusing world, is a peace that passes all understanding. It is the peace that knows that company is coming.
Oh, come, Emmanuel.
Everyone, pray with us, please. Oh, come to us, abide with us, O Lord Emmanuel. God with us, you came to us long ago as a helpless babe, as one in need of human love and care. You taught us how to love and care for one another. Help us to hold on to childlike wonder, amazement, and love, and help us to love one another all year long. Guide our feet into the way of peace, as only the Prince of Peace can lead us, by laying down our lives for one another and serving one another. In the name of Christ Emmanuel, God with us, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Walker family. Great job, all of you, all four of you. Great, thank you. Appreciate that. Well, we are continuing with our songs of Christmas, and last week we did it with singing, and it involved me and you, and today we're going to do the same. So the song or Christmas hymn or carol, however you want to say it, for today is Hark the Herald, Angels Sing. Maybe you have done that caroling, or maybe you remember doing that in a traditional service or something like that. But I'm going to invite you to stand up with me real quick, and we are going to sing together Hark the Herald, Angels Sing, first verse, okay? Here we go.
The herald angels sing, glory
to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
All right, great job. Y'all did great. Thank you so much. Remain standing because we're going to read our scripture for today. Band's going to go ahead and make their way down, but our scripture this morning comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. It begins right here. It says, And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, on earth peace to those on whom His favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things in her heart and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. You know, as Christians, we love Christmas songs. We love all kinds of songs, whether they're traditional hymns, more hymns, or even some of the fun songs that we sing. You know, in years past, we've done Christmas caroling and you know, going door to door. We don't do that so much these days, but I hope we bring that back after we get past all this COVID mess. And next year, we go out Christmas caroling because it just brings such joy to people's hearts to hear the songs of Christmas. And that's part of what inspired this sermon series is to talk about the joy that comes from the reminder of who Christ is, what God did when He sent His only Son to be born in that humble stable. You know, it's even more than just the fact that when we sing the Christmas songs or the Christmas carols that we get into this spirit of Christmas. It's even more than that because it's really, for us as Christians, it's about the fact that we are giving God the glory and the praise for what He has done for us through the birth of Jesus Christ. You know, as United Methodists, we have a particular affinity for the hymns of Charles Wesley. You know, John and Charles Wesley, the Wesley brothers in England, they were the founding fathers, so to speak, of the Methodist Church, more so John as he began to organize it. But Charles, he was one that really helped us to put our theology into song. During Easter, in traditional services, you'll hear them sing, "Christ the Lord is risen today." And there's even contemporary versions of that song as well. And throughout the year, we sing things like, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing." That's a great Charles Wesley hymn. And then, of course, during Christmas, whether it's in a contemporary service or traditional service, we love to sing, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing," which is another one of Charles Wesley's great hymns. If John Wesley was known for being the organizer and founder of Methodism, Charles certainly was the one who organized the theology of the early church, putting it into song. And so as we continue to focus our attention on, during this Advent time, on the songs of Christmas, it is fitting for us as Methodists to focus in on a Charles Wesley Christmas carol hymn today. And that one, of course, is being "Hark the Herald Angels Sing." Is a poetic song which recalls that glorious night when the shepherds were watching their sheep. They thought it was just going to be another old night watching these smelly old sheep, and something glorious happens instead. It's one that we love to sing every year, but I'm here to tell you that if Charles Wesley was with us today, he would have refused to sing it. Yes, he was the author of the song, but he still would have refused to sing it. Now, why? Why is it? Because he refused to sing it back then. He refused to sing "Hark the Herald." Why is that? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. But first, let's look a little more into what the hymn speaks about. A group of lowly shepherds are out in the fields at night, watching over their flocks. They were the third shift crew. They were the night shift, if you would, the night shift shepherds. They were the ones who were stuck with the least desired job and the least desired shift. You see, the job of shepherding was not a glorified job back then. If you were a shepherd, you were low man on the totem pole. You had the lowliest job. Nobody wanted. In fact, part of the issue was you weren't even more than likely watching your own sheep. People didn't. They may have had small herds for families, but people that watched flocks of sheep were actually hired people who got paid very little to watch sheep for larger groupings, richer people, if you would, that own these large flocks. And so here these guys are, the lowest of the low on the social totem pole, the third shift workers, the low end. In fact, if they were the bottom of the totem pole, they were really the dirt under the totem pole. I mean, that's how they were considered. Smelly shepherds watching smelly sheep doing the job that nobody else wanted to do. And then it happened. Then it happened. The angel of the Lord appeared to the lowest of the low. This great and glorious angel of God appeared in all of its glory, shone all around him, and the night sky became bright as day. Now, it's understandable that the scriptures say, and they were terrified. I would be terrified. You would be terrified if suddenly the sky just lit up and there's this guy standing up in the sky and you're like, ah, what's going on? What does the angel say to them? Do not be afraid. And the angel came proclaiming good news, speaking peace and proclaiming good news of the Savior's birth. And if that wasn't enough, suddenly he was joined with an archangel or an angelic choir who sang of God's glory, who sang of peace, and who sang of God's favor. And then Luke tells us that the shepherds went off to Bethlehem to see this great thing that God has done and to pay a visit to Joseph and Mary and the baby Jesus. And then what do? They went off to tell others the good news of what they had seen and heard. And then they came back and praised and gave glory to God. The story of the shepherds and the angels is one of great contrast. Here in this story, we have this birth announcement that's being made. An announcement that of a Savior's birth, you know, you would think it would be made to emperors and kings, but not to the least, the last, and the lost. Smelly shepherds among smelly sheep sleeping under stars. Earlier in Luke's gospel, in chapter 2, verse 1, we read of how Emperor Augustus had sought to exert his power and sovereignty over the world by requiring everyone to go be registered in their hometown. This was a great inconvenience. You couldn't just, this isn't just like it is today where you maybe go down to your CPA's house or office and you get their taxes filled out and all this kind of stuff. If they're going to tax people, they want to know where they're from, how much they're going to tax them. And so they made them all go back and be registered so that they could get more money out of them, basically, is all this was. And you couldn't just, you know, get on the internet and say, this is where I live, this is my address, send. No, you had to physically go from where you were living then to back to where you originated from and there be registered. And that's exactly what Mary and Joseph had to do. Quirinius had been governor then, but it was not to Quirinius and it was not to Augustus that God chose to make the world's greatest birth announcement. Mary was correct when she asserted in Luke chapter 1, verse 52, that he, referring to God, has brought down the powerful from their thrones and instead lifted up the lowly. We also see that the angel of the Lord did not go to the temple or the synagogue to make this glorious announcement. No, it was not to scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees for whom this good news was proclaimed. It was proclaimed to the lowliest of the low, to the despised, to the ones who mothers grew up saying, I hope my boy doesn't grow up to be a shepherd. This is whom God made his proclamation. His glory was not manifest in the temple that day, but rather that night, but rather it was manifest in the field. You see, how it was made and to whom this birth announcement was made is just as important a message as what the message was itself. Think about that. To whom this birth announcement was given and how it was given and the circumstances of it were just as important as the words of the birth announcement themselves. That night, the whole world was put on notice. God was doing a new thing. Salvation was not just for the high and mighty, not just for the holier than thou. God's salvation was for all, even the least, the last, and the lost. Hark how the welkin ring, glory to the King of Kings. Now, that doesn't make sense to you right there, does it? You're like, wait a second, David, that's not the words of the hymn as we sing it. Hark how the welkin rings, glory to the King of Kings. But these actually were the original words that Charles Wesley wrote when he wrote this hymn. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the... That's not how Charles Wesley originally wrote this song. Now, welkin, there's probably not a person in here. Is there anybody in here who knows the definition of welkin? Anybody? I can't see how. Let me see. Nobody. See? Okay. So it's not a known word. But the word welkin actually means the vault of heaven makes a long noise. Kind of an unusual word. The vault of heaven makes a long noise. Well, that word was even archaic back when Charles Wesley used it to write the hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And so another contemporary of Charles Wesley, a guy by the name of George Whitefield. And a great picture of George there. I'm sure he loves that. He almost looks cross-eyed in that picture. But George Whitefield was a street preacher like Wesley, like John Wesley. In fact, it was George Whitefield that helped to get John Wesley to go out into the streets to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Before that, John Wesley thought that you could only proclaim Christ in the church houses and in the sanctuary buildings, and so he wouldn't do that. But Whitefield was out going to the mines, and he was out going to the street corners, and he was proclaiming Christ wherever he went, and he convinced John Wesley to do the same. Well, the same George Whitefield got a hold of the words of this Charles Wesley hymn, and he changed them to what he thought would be a better word choice so that people would understand it. Because like I said, that word welkin was actually old even back then. Whitefield, who was known for being influential with John Wesley, was not welcome at being influential over the song that Charles Wesley wrote. And although the exact reasons of why Whitefield did what he did with Charles Wesley's hymn, and then he went on not only to change the words, but to publish them as in that change, we don't know why he did that. We don't know why he didn't ask Charles Wesley for permission. All that we know is the hymn we sing today is the one that was adapted by George Whitefield. What we do know from history is that the change greatly distressed Charles Wesley, so much so that he refused to sing the hymn ever. And according to the problem with it was that according to Wesley, and technically he's right when you look at it, but according to Wesley, the angels did not sing of the Savior's birth. Now, if you go back and you look at the scriptures, you'll discover this is right. Wesley was getting stuck on this. Charles Wesley was getting really stuck on this. He was like, listen, I want us to be theologically correct. And so he was like, listen, the angels sang of God's glory. The angels sang of God's peace. The angels sang of God's favor. But the birth announcement was verbally given by the first angel and not by the host of angels. I think he's getting a little too caught up in himself. Yes, he's technically right, but he got so caught up in these words that he had written and so caught up in all this that he actually missed, I think, the overall joy of the song and the word choices. Now, I have all amount of respect for Charles Wesley as well as his brothers John, but his argument about whether the angels actually sung about the birth of Jesus or merely proclaimed it verbally and his frustration to the point of refusing to sing his own song with these slight provisions, and it goes a little far for me, and I think it probably goes a little far for you as well. The message of the hymn, the message this Christmas carol embodies, and the story it tells of the greatest birth announcement ever made is far more important than getting one's feathers ruffled up over whether the birth announcement was actually spoken or sung. The important thing is that the birth announcement was actually made, and to whom it was made was even just as important, for it conveyed the reality that salvation was not just for the high and mighty. Salvation was not just for those that were overly religious. Salvation was something that God was offering, was extending to everyone. And here's the thing, folks. We need to remember what the shepherds did once they received this birth announcement, because God makes this birth announcement to us today. What did the shepherds do? Well, first they went to check it out for themselves, but then the scriptures say they went out and they went off and they told others about what they had seen and what they had heard. And others learned about the Savior's birth from them. We, like the angels, have been given this charge to share the good news of the birth of Jesus Christ. We have been given this charge as believers in Jesus Christ to share the good news that this baby that is born this day, that the baby that is born, that we celebrate this time of the year, is the Savior of the world. And the world desperately needs to receive this Savior for themselves. We have this charge to share God's salvation message with the least, the last, and the lost, with the high and the holy, with those that have wealth and those that have none, those that are in the inside, those that are on the outside, to share this message with everyone we see. For God wants everyone to know of His saving love in Jesus Christ. And so I don't care how you do it. You can do it with words and you can do it with song. It doesn't matter. Go and proclaim the news of the Savior's birth. Amen? Amen. Would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, the greatest gift that has ever been given was given by You in Jesus Christ. And Lord, we want to celebrate that during this season. We don't want to get caught up in the commercialism of Christmas. We don't get caught up in the stress of this year. We don't want to get caught up in trying to figure out how do we do Christmas this year. But Lord, we want to get caught up in Jesus. And so it is our prayer this morning, Lord, that You would place it on our heart to make this proclamation boldly. To boldly share the love of Christ with everyone we come in contact with. To boldly speak of His salvation that He offers to everyone. To boldly share Your love with the world. Help us to do that in word, in song, in action and deed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and everybody said together, amen. If you're here this morning, God's moving your heart and life, and you're ready to receive that gift of new life in Christ, come talk to Tammy and I. Let us pray with you. Let's answer any questions you may have about it. Maybe you've already done that, and you're now ready to take a step of faith by becoming a member of Fuller First Methodist Church. Come talk to us about that as well. We want to answer any questions. We want to talk to you about what it means to be a member, the responsibility of that. So come talk to us this week if you want. Give us a call. But this time, I want to invite you to stand and join us as we sing our closing song, Face of God.
Underneath the starry sky, a mother holds a child tonight. And all is calm and all is bright. She sings to Him a lullaby. And Gloria, I hear the angels singing. Savior of the world is in. the face of God.
I want to invite you, if you want to come back a little bit later on this morning, 11 a.m. in our traditional service, the choir is going to be doing their cantata this morning. So it'll be a different kind of a service. You want to join us for that, you're welcome to do that as well. Of course, Sunday school is now happening right after this. We've got the family friendly in here in the front of the Family Life Center. We've got Jason Jones class meets in here. We've got adult classes meeting together over in Harper Hall. So please know about that as well. We'd love for you to come back. And don't forget about Christmas Eve. Two services. We'd love to have you here at 5 o'clock. Or if you want to come to our traditional service over at 7 o'clock in the sanctuary, you're welcome to do that. Both services will have communion. Both services will have candle lighting. So come for that if you would. Invite your friends, invite your neighbors, invite your family. We'd love to see all of you guys. Would you receive now this benediction? Go forth in the power and strength that God gives you to be the children of God, to proclaim the good news of the Savior's birth in song, in voice, in action. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and everybody join together saying, amen. Go in peace.